Okay, great. So I'll let everybody get, you know, shaken out and settled down and all that.
We're 2 years in already.
Yeah,
that's awesome. So I can just say whatever I want here, but
can we hear
talking on the internet? Okay. Well, hello everybody. Thank you, Eric, for inviting me so much to speak.
Thank you.
My name is Michelle Coutinho. I've been a graphic designer for about 12 years now, and 4 years ago I started teaching visual art and graphic design. But more important than that, I feel, and definitely you'll see from my lecture, I'm a human being, and I feel like a lot of us in technology, we get like completely gone from that part of ourselves. And I'm interested in transcendence. I'm interested in the hero's journey and the things that make us human. And the reason why I got into storytelling or graphic design in the first place was because I came into college as a creative writer, and I love art and sculpture. And there's this sculpture in the Louvre, it's Cupid and Psyche, and it's this just romantic sculpture of Cupid holding, he's an angel, for those of you who don't know, with wings, and he's holding his beloved. And I was just writing poetry and putting poetry together. And then I was like, what is this web design thing, you know, back in the day? And you could put art and poetry together and evoke emotion. And I think that is the most powerful way to communicate to an audience and to tell a story, is to really get into that visceral space with people. And I feel like in our current day and age of technology, that's what we're lacking, is that real connected. So this presentation will really be about that. So let's continue. So to start with a quote, in this day and age, a picture is worth more than just 1,000 words. And this is from Getty Images, which is a great source for pictures and photography. When it is genuine, when it is relevant and yet eternal, right? When it is so powerful that it goes beyond sight and it delves into our senses, that is the kind of image that is worth a million. And images only take a second to read. Because I don't know if you guys are in school or you're already designing and developing, but people don't read anymore. They just kind of skim things. And so they'll go through your blog and they'll read the headline, maybe the subtext, then they'll go all the way down the page, and then they'll look at the pictures, the visual imagery, and then maybe if that enchants them, they'll actually read the content. So having really powerful visual media that's driving your story and kind of tells the story without people having to read is very effective. And people have almost 100%, a 94% click rate if there's a picture versus if there's not a picture. So, I mean, that's like almost all of them. You know, it's like minus 6%. Plato said, those who rule society, or those who tell the stories rule society. And we can see that in the current age, and I'm not going to get political at all in this moment, but you can see that people who just talk and tell whatever kind of story with whatever kind of flair or impact that they want, those are the people that gather people listening to them. And so, I mean, come on. So this is something that I wrote. It says, the more that we as storytellers express themes that connect to what is meaningful and visceral within us, and that which is expressed universally through emotion, is how deeply that we're going to connect to our audiences. So as designers, we have to think about that. It's like, what is meaningful to us, and how it's like the user experience. We're putting ourselves in the user's place and then designing from there. It's the same thing when we're telling a story or creating any kind of media or educational content. And then stories are primal. They exist within us. They're in our DNA, our bones. We're going to go into the caveman days now. This is one of the first cave drawings. And if you can't see it because it's a little light there, it's hands, it's imprints of hands with red, like clay or red paint put on that. And you know what that tells me? That tells me I'm alive. I'm here. See me. See that I was here. Do you remember that from the 90s, WZ, UZ? Like, Alan was here. That's that. But, you know, this is a primal desire to be seen, to be felt, to be heard, to be expressed. Eric is still writing, was here. Check under the desk here in the office. So it's really important that we realize that we have primal needs and primal desires, and that human beings are primal beings. We are driven by emotion. We have 8 primal desires, according to Drew Eric Whitman and Emily Warden. They are survival, protection, freedom, comfort, pleasure, relationships, success, and likability. A lot of those are social, right? And a lot of those are emotional. And pretty much all of them are relational, right? Like 5 out of 8 have to do with the fact that I'm connecting to you, I'm being seen, pleasure, relationship, success in relationship to another person, right? So these are how we are, this is how we are wired, like DNA-wise. We are wired to relate, we're tribal creatures, and we're going to get into that a little bit deeper. So stories, let's see, yes. So so we have been creating stories since the dawn of man. This mask, you know, it reminds me, this is a Japanese mask, but also think about the Greeks, think about tragedies and plays, and we've been creating stories to explain our emotional states and what happens relationally within all of us since forever. Shakespeare, all of it, it's moving, it's art, it's language. Since language was created and even before, we're trying to express what life is and why we are here and what's our relationship to life, right? And so we've created mythologies in order to explain that because we really don't know why we're here or what our relationship to each other in life is. So we've created stories in order to architect that. And Joseph Campbell's gonna tell us in 1 second a little bit better than I can because he is the master of it.
What do you think our souls owe to ancient myths?
Well, the ancient myths were designed to put the mind, the mental system, into accord with this body system, with this inheritance
a harmony?
Of the body, to harmonize. The mind can ramble off in strange ways and want things that the body does not want. And the myths and rites were means to put the mind in accord with the body and the way of life in accord with the way that nature dictates.
So in a way, these old stories live in us.
They do indeed. And the stages of a human development are the same today as they were in the ancient times. And the problem of a child brought up in a world of discipline, of obedience, and of his dependency on others has to be transcended when one comes to maturity, so that you are living now not in dependency, but with self-responsible authority. And the problem of the transition from childhood to maturity, and then from maturity and full capacity to losing those powers and acquiescing in the natural course of, you might say, the autumn time of life and the passage away. Myths are there to help us go with it, accept nature's way and not hold to something else.
The stories are sort of, to me, like messages in a bottle from shores someone else has visited first.
Yes, and you're visiting those shores now.
And these myths tell me how others have made the passage? And how I can make the path.
And also what the beauties are of the way. I feel this now, moving into my own last years, you know. The myths help me to go with it.
So, the passage of time. And there was something that I really wanted to articulate that I was talking about. Something about storytelling in general is why do we watch stories or why do we learn stories? It's because somebody's gotten there first and we're trying to get the information. It wasn't exactly what I was trying to say. It was something about like this is, I wish that I could remember what I just thought, but it was like, yes, that's why we watch movies. It's just this power of understanding, yeah, just things that we will either go through or have gone through, and we'll talk about it in this next slide, why not, right? So this is just by living on this earth, right? Just by being here and being alive, we endure these certain themes. One of them is polarity, right? There's masculine and there is feminine. There is light and there is dark, right? There is good and evil, birth and death and rebirth. And that's what he was talking about in the cycles of life that we all have to endure and kind of submit to and succumb to and understand our relationship with and go with, whether we like it or not, you know, like relationships blossom, relationships die, everything changes. This is the natural way of things. And this is kind of getting to what I was hearing. Every time I listen to that video in preparation for this talk, I hear something different. But it's like we have to, to bring it back to this, primal forces, like elemental forces, like wind, water, and fire, like we are in relationship to all of these things, and all these things are changing and moving through us. And so we have to understand our identification with it and how we embody it. And our relationship to those things are either challenging or not. And that's all a visceral experience for us. So as we are communicating those ideas, that's all going to create emotion in your audience. Not exactly where I was going to go with that, but that works as well. So these forces are universally relatable and can be archetypically depicted in the visual imagery that we use as storytellers. So if we're using visual storytelling, we're using visual images that relate to these subjects, relate to these forces of nature, then we will create relatable stories. Okay, so let's bring it into today's day and age. We are storytellers. I like that image made you smile. We're storytellers, and we're the media. We get to go with our, like even you right now, when you're taking pictures of the slides, you know, like you can Instagram later and say that, you know, this is what I learned today, and this is what I'm doing, right? So we have the opportunity and the moment to be creators. Which is beautiful and a blessing of social media, and it also creates this principle of authenticity. This is actually what is really happening in my life. This is my dinner tonight, which remember when everybody was posting a food on Instagram, like it was crazy? And now we're doing it like this is my daughter, this is what I'm learning, and these are micro moments of expression of authentically how we live our lives. And then as we post that to our audiences, whether it's our Facebook feeds or our brand identity, because in the research I did for this, like brands, when you don't want fake, modeled, photoshopped, nobody cares about that anymore, because in the age of social media, that authentic, gritty, like I'm doing a live video for my staircase, is what people will click on because it's relatable, because there's an authentic connection, because they do videos on their staircase, or they want to, or they wish they could. So then they'll be an advocate for your brand or even just you, you know, because they are feeling like a closeness. They either want to be you or they feel like they are you, you know. So so user-generated content, right, reveals real people, real places, and meaning in real moments and emotions, right, that establish a new kind of heightened digital intimacy. However, I have this whole other theory about this, and maybe you guys can relate to this. So social media and technology, and this is kind of where I was going in the beginning, where I was like, well, I'm also a human. Though we have access, I have the best, Facebook is the biggest phone book that I've ever had, right? I have 1,500 people that I've known for the last, since 2009, that are still connected to me in whatever way, and some people from high school that I can reach out, but do I really have authentic connection with any of those people? No. And am I a little bit more claustrophobic, I would say, about sharing things because there are so many people on my feed? Yes. So does that create real connection and intimacy? No, it doesn't. It creates isolation and separation, which is like how this whole entire universe or society is actually set up. So the irony of social media is though I can reach out and give a message to the masses, I don't really feel comfortable doing that completely. And I don't feel like I'm in authentic communication with a lot of people because we're all putting our best face forward, right? But there's that saying, that meme, I wish my life was as cool as I presented to be on Facebook, you know? So, and then moving into brand identity. So I've got two Facebook feed posts from Elephant Journal that are up. This is just talking specifically about how they use visual imagery to create a hook, right? To get you to click on the article. Now, I've noticed a little thing, and no disrespect to my friend Waylon Lewis, I love Elephant Journal so much, I love what they stand for. However, the social media, the people, and I may be one of them one day because you never know the way roads end up, but what I noticed is that it is very much a hook and a visceral experience. So say that I just broke up in a relationship and I see twin, soulmate, love, flame, etc. Because I have a visceral primal desire for connection and intimacy in this world that completely lacks it, I'm going to click on that because I'm like, oh, my heart clicks, you know? But then when I read the article, like sometimes when you read the article, it's actually like, it's superficial, it's stale, there's no actual connection. Doing this too much over time as a brand will create distrust and a negative user experience. So you don't want to just put really provocative images to hook your user and not follow up with like some really good vibrational content that like is of the same depth, you know? But I see that. I mean, it works on Facebook, and you kind of have to forgive Facebook a little bit because it is so superficial, but if you're really trying to create a meaningful message, like don't do the wow factor, like really authentically create something so people can actually feel what you're trying to say. Same thing with this is a woman in the hospital with no hair and it's a dying wife, and if you're going through a death or have just gone through something, I mean, the gut reaction in you is going to long for connection and click on that article or share it because that's your part of your identity now. We have 6 universal human emotions, and I just wanted to put this graphic up there. So we only have 6 universal human emotions, and we can boil everything that we experience on a day-to-day level to having one of these reactions to it, right? And one of them is happiness, and the rest is very, very primal, like shock, fear, anger, contempt or disgust, and sadness. It's fascinating to me. So let's go into now the 4 principles of visual storytelling according to Getty Images and NewsCrest's beautiful research article that they did. We talked a little bit already about authentically relating to people, authenticity. We're going to talk a little bit about sensory. I feel like this image in particular, this is John Malkovich, I think it encompasses all of them very much. Archetype, I mean, you can feel, like you can feel and taste and see and know what this guy is transmitting just from the visual. And relevancy, whether it relates to culture. We're going to go into archetype in the most in-depth because that's the most meaningful for me and that's what I'd like to share with you. But let's talk about sensory really quick. Before we go into that, do you guys know what sensory, does anybody want to shout out maybe what sensory is? Sensory imagery?
Relating to the senses?
Yes, ding, ding, ding. So sensory imagery is like an image that you can taste. You know, something that engages all of your senses. By having an image that engages your senses, like look at this person coming out of the water, like you can feel what, everybody knows we have a visceral response to that, a reaction to that. We know what it feels like to be cleansed, right? We know what it feels like to be like, oh my God, or even to be reborn, you know? Like, so that image right there of being cleansed could actually have an archetypal connection to rebirth. Right? So, or you can go for advertising campaigns like they've done since since TV came out where they were just like, chocolate, you know, the chocolate like rolls down a finger like the honey or whatever like that, you're just like, oh, I'm hungry. Because you're an animal and they know it and they're marketing to the animal within you, so you have a primal reaction to that. So that's why it's like luscious peaches, like, you know, smoothie, like healthy lifestyle. Okay. So that's sensory images. It turns us on, and therefore we react to it, we engage. Okay, so we have also archetypes. So here's our story of archetypes. Does anybody want to speak of what an archetype is? Yes?
Like a reoccurring pattern of a personal type or like a character type.
Yes, perfect.
Seen throughout stories, throughout history, throughout legends.
Oh, very good. So this is a Balinese sculpture, and it's Arjun. Does anybody know about the Bhagavad Gita? A little bit? Yeah, we're in Boulder, right? So
yeah.
It works. Bhagavad Gita, good. I also have a yoga teacher, so there's a little bit of that in. So it's a Balinese sculpture that represents this hero archetype, and this hero story is in our culture, ingrained in our culture, and I'll talk again with Joseph Campbell personally. But that story is great. But this is also something else that this hero represents. And these statues are all over Indonesia, and they represent valor, right? The warrior archetype is a noble archetype. He's also a student of Krishna, right? So it's really about like the man who is in his noblest, truest self. He's a hunter, right? So he's in the divine masculine. There's all of this expression from just this one, like he's the hero, right? So he's noble, he's studious, he's in service to truth. There's a lot of, again, like that, like how it can relate to being reborn, just seeing somebody in water, you know? And there's a deeper meaning to these images, and when we really work with that, we are creating these visceral stories that really engage with our audiences. So you always want to think about that, like how can this image be conveyed? And also negatively, like how could this be a way that I wouldn't even think about it, but somebody who has a wound or somebody where you're like, oh no, we should put that picture there because that's gonna make, oh, you know? I mean, when you're on design teams, you'll think about things like that, so. So the core universal story that is embedded within our human psyche and our collective consciousness is this hero's journey. According to Joseph Campbell, all of us in this, and you heard him talk about it in the video, the transcendence from adolescence to adulthood, which we all have to go through, and what we all have to do is really kind of tell our parents' conditioning, right, to kind of put it aside, and we have to individuate from the collective, whether it be the tribal society back in the day that we came from, or now our parents and their consciousness, and then we have to stand on our own and have our own platform and our own reasoning. And we will all, it's an initiation story, right? So these initiation stories make us into who we are. The hero with a thousand faces, as those archetypes play out throughout this hero's journey. So you'll be on your own journey, you'll be on a path, and you will meet different character archetypes on that path. That moment will have pitfalls and traps and highlights, and those are archetypal parts of your story as well. Knowing these archetypes are embedded in our collective consciousness is super powerful for being a storyteller, because that's what George Lucas did when he did Star Wars. He was a student of Joseph Campbell, and that, look how powerful that story is, and all of those archetypes and those, that character Parthenon, if you will, like a Greek mythology, like this is what drives our human consciousness, because those archetypes are within us. They are embedded within us, and therefore they are so relatable, because we all have that jester within. We all have the saboteur within, you know, or the teacher, or the artist, whatever it is, but they're within us. So when we see them outside of ourselves, we're like, yes, yes, go, hero, go, you know, whatever it is. Also on the path, right? So going back to the rhythms of the universe, the rhythms of our day, we have birth, we have death, sunrise, sunset, rebirth, and renewal, right? Much like the seasons day after day, we have the opportunity to rise again. That Phoenix archetype is an archetype in our consciousness. We know that because the sun sets and it comes back. We know that after winter must come spring. We understand that we will have that opportunity. That's again in our collective psyche, right? But also these points of initiation. We know what this feels like. We know what heartbreak and despair feels like, the dark night of the soul. So when that is depicted, we know what it is to feel alone and sad and sorrowful, and we can relate to that. We can be moved by that. So if somebody's depicting that, or you're creating a story that depicts that, that will be relatable, even if it's, you know, there's negative emotion. Well, I wouldn't call it negative. There's just, it's more, it's deep, it's visceral, it's true, is what it is. Religious scripture and mythology is filled with these stories of good that overcomes evil, and that battle between these polar opposites. So we have to really be mindful of that space, of where that is, and the balance of these things, the balance of these archetypes, and how they relate to each other. So here's a quote from Carl Jung. In addition to our immediate consciousness, right, which is very personal, there exists a second system that's a collective system that's identical for everybody. So there is a theory that we all have one mind, and that mind is in the collective consciousness, and we are all tapped into it, can draw ideas down from it. That's what they say artists do, right? The muses, they hear those ideas, or the music comes in through the ether. That's that collective space. I teach mantra as well, mantra workshops, the sound Om. It's a primordial sound that exists from the unmanifest, from that collective space, and then we draw those sounds, or we draw that art piece, like these beautiful pieces on the wall, right? From those visceral, emotional experiences. From nothing, we create something. We create sound, word. I mean, we're always like the, you know, back to the beginning of time. Just important, I think, to be able to relate to now, because those things are eternal. So let's talk about brand identity for a second. Brand identity can also have archetypes. Right? And this is all very, this is good for marketing, this is good for understanding who your audience is. What is the brand archetype of your audience, right? Are you appealing to rich mothers who all have college education, you know? And all those women are going to, or who are entrepreneurial in some sense. And what do they look like? Like women that I see speak, and Marie Forleo, they all have a certain branding. Like, the women in there with their journals and their manicures and their pearls, you know? Like, and so you know what that kind of, that archetype is in this modern society. So I'm going to fuel my brand to gear towards that. So when I have pictures of myself, it'll be like, I'm relatable, I'm just like you. Or, you know, it could be, this was one of my favorite ones, the innocent, right? Or the gesture, which is Ronald McDonald, right? He's just like, oh, that's not what I'm doing, buy imagery. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it appeals to your audience that way. And then the explorer with North Face, I mean, there's so much North, I mean, me too, guilty as charged for the winter, but Colorado is like, North Face, I'm the explorer, I'm the outside, it's in Colorado, you know what I mean? Very polar. So it's very trendy. You know, what was that?
I drive a Subaru.
Right, exactly. Right, so an outback, totally, I know. So there are trends in collective consciousness and collectives, right? There are trends in collectives, and brands know that, and you think about that, and then you appeal to your audience in that way. These are the brand archetypes that you could have. You've got the adventurer, the sage, the wise one, the jester, the helper, like I love that, the caregiver, Johnson & Johnson. And when we architect our brand and create visual stories around those archetypes, then we can draw in our user because they feel more connected to us because, again, it's inside of us, so we see it outside and we want. One more quote from Jung because he's awesome. The contents of the collective unconscious are archetypes. They are primordial images that reflect basic patterns that are common to us all and which have existed universally since the dawn of time. Wanted to say that like that. And this is a... So these are universal themes. So here's some images. And you can see the guy in the middle, he's very happy. He's obviously like won something. So these are points on the path, right? And his point on the path is like that victory lap, you know, that champion. I am the champion now. I am embodying the champion archetype. The first one's the explorer. This one is sadness. There's that feeling of being held up by, like, nothing can go wrong, you know, when you're just in the flow and you're just like, yes, hallelujah. And then there's the finding of inner peace. You know, these are all universal points on a story. On your own hero's journey, you might meet all of those points. And you can tell all, you can understand that whole entire story or archetype just by that picture. You know, like, I know finding my calm center. I know that moment where everything is quiet and I'm like, here. You know, and that you can just, the right picture and convict, can change the whole environment of the room. You know, it can change that whole, the whole architecture of the story. It's beautiful. Very powerful. Pam Grossman is the director of visual trends and Getty Images, and she says the sweet spot happens. So you find, you know that you found the right, the sexiest image that you could possibly find for your story. When you find an image that taps into something ancient, and timeless and universal, right? So it hits those doom, 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 but it is completely relevant and contemporary. And we're gonna get into the last principle now, which is relevancy. Relevancy has to do with whether it relates to what's actually happening now or your article in general. You can't just have provocative images, like I said, and have them not totally relate to your article at all because you have a bummed out user. But these are for connecting through global human values. This I love. So we believe in, as human beings, in a primal sense, we believe in happiness, right? We believe, those are our six, and we believe that's like, we have six emotions, one of them is happiness and joy. We believe that that's a good one, you know, right? We want that one over all the other ones. We believe in life, we believe in love, we believe in family. We have these cultural values that go across the nations, across the board, across the individuals. These are forever. Now, in the collective consciousness or in the cultural society, does anybody recognize this?
Dude, is that Statue of Liberty making out with
Lady Justice?
Lady Justice.
So when I saw this meme on Facebook, it's a symbol of equality. And I loved it because what a culturally relevant idea and meme. Now, as artists and creators, we have a responsibility to, well, yes, we have a responsibility to, especially if we're pushing an idea that we feel advocacy for, that we are being an activist for, we get to push the boundaries of our audience's thinking, right? And good art does that. That's what good art does, is it takes something that's culturally relevant and then mixes it with an idea and goes, there you go, deal with that. And then if that idea is accepted into the norm, it becomes the collective. Just like, I mean, we've seen with gay marriage over the last 10 years, it has, it, you know, and marijuana laws here. It is like progressive is happening very slowly and kind of back and forth, but there is a progression happening and good art does that. We push the boundaries of our audience. That just turns, I love that. I think it's very important. So we live in Boulder, Colorado. everybody. And so we are on the cutting edge of people who have this privilege of being, number one, super digital and techie, but also have the collective consciousness here is affluent and healthy and has a wellness mentality towards it. And is very, this can change the way that we do business out in the whole entire world or just in this nation. We have a responsibility to radiate that consciousness and that culture outward into the world because this world actually needs it. So there's a health consciousness culture that exists here in this bubble that we share together that we need to present to the rest of the world. It's kind of our responsibility to do it. And then the last thing I want to talk about is the ancient meaning. So another way to go back and to evoke emotion and to connect with people through visual storytelling is that remembrance that we all have to that tribal way of society that we're disconnected to currently. And that tribal way of society has truth in it. It embodies wisdom, it embodies an archetype of true wisdom because it was once, or we once lived in harmony with nature. We once lived in harmony with the natural rhythms. That's what we are attempting to do here amidst this technological age in Boulder. So to combine those two, relevancy, but also to evoke that memory of when we did actually respect our neighbor or treat others as we wanted to be treated or think of the good of the whole more than the good of the self. And today we live in this capitalist society which is very separation consciousness of ego or me versus you or what can I get over you, right? And back in the day, we didn't do that. We had initiation rites that brought us into a sense of humility to the earth, to nature, to each other, where we were just more respectful to each other. And I think that's important to remember, and it's a really good way to evoke emotion from your audience to get in touch with the universal truth that's culturally and relevantly, it interweaves us all because we all passionately believe in that. Yeah. So we all believe in families and we all believe in love, really, ultimately, is the ultimate truth. To be safe and to be connected and to share love with each other, that's what humans crave. That's what we want to do. We want to get beyond the superficiality and really understand and connect with each other. We teach and honor future generations. I just want to read this. As we go back to these principles of universal love, integrity, and true community, that's what it is. That's the essence of what I'm sharing with you right now. Is this? There's a depth of relating to each other as, I would say, as souls, or as beings on this earth, as opposed to people who we are selling to, or people who we are schmoozing with, or networking with, but going beyond all of that, and actually like remembering, like, yeah, we're human beings, and we're telling stories because we love them, and we understand each other as human beings, and we want to bring that collective energy into this world so that our future generations also have that collective consciousness, and they remember what's really important. Because as human beings, all that we really care about is just being in harmony with each other because we want to be in harmony with this whole entire planet. And that's enough to share. So.